Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. Hope you guys are doing all right. Just wanted to come on here and make a quick video. there are some of you who follow Joshua's ministry. I'm going to put the link below here for the Facebook group. If you're not on Facebook, you know, you can always make an anonymous account. I invite you to join the Joshua's ministry group. You can come on there, and I post pictures almost every day, every 2 or 3 days. And you can see all the different things we're doing. The feedings, mostly what I post, and then the orphans sometimes. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I have a special prayer request. If you guys, I tried to make a video the other day. It's the day my sound was messing up on my computer. So I don't know what all I've said in the videos I posted. But, you know, the Lord had led me about making 2 more orphanages, and that's why I came here, was to make at least 1 more. But the Lord had spoken to me about 2. And so I just had said, well, if the money comes in to buy the land for orphanage number 3, I'll come here and stay like 3 months. In a short period of time, I can at least buy the land and check up on the orphans and all that. And, you know, there, of course, while I was gone, you know, there are lots of little things come up. You know, they're just the, kind of the normal things you deal with. Disputes between the 2 orphanages, who's in charge and about the budget. And all this kind of silly stuff. So I get all that worked out and get everything all back in order and readjusted. And it's, you know, it's a work in progress. You can't follow a cookie cutter always. You have to, you know, have a flexible system, especially when you're talking about doing something for the Lord. A lot of times the wealthy people that the Lord has had me deal with, extremely wealthy people, people whose 1 tithe for 1 month would be enough to build more than an orphanage. People whose tithe is probably way more than that. More than $60,000 a month would be their tithe if they ever decided to tithe for the Lord. We can build an orphanage every month. This is one of the people that I met sometimes, brothers and sisters. Anyway, so when you deal with lots of times, people that are super wealthy from business, most of them become wealthy from business if they didn't inherit it. They, you know, people look at everything as a business model, and when, and that's where, you know, you have a dispute with, you cannot use your carnal mind and earthly ways to do God's business. It's got to be done God's way. Now, of course, we're supposed to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves, the Lord says. So, of course, we need to use the best business practices that we can, as long as it doesn't run contrary to the Word of God. And then there's always grace. It's just like the law. You've got the law, which is, you know, which has got rules and it's good and all those things. But grace overrides those times because we're all human. No one can keep the law. And we have the grace of God. So the same thing is true when you're talking about an orphanage or a church or whatever, you know. And that's what I'm talking about. I was an altar worker while I was going to Bible school. After I had been an assistant pastor in a church, a small church, and then when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, then I transferred to, I was really not very welcome anymore in the Baptist church I was in. When I experienced this, the baptism of the Holy Spirit in the Baptist church, some of the, well, you know, the leadership didn't like it. I'll put it that way. The people thought it's awesome. The move of God is awesome. But the leadership, you know. But anyway, so I moved and became an altar worker while I went to Bible college at a big old Assemblies of God church, over like 5,000 plus people. And as an altar worker, I went to meetings, and I had already been, you know, developing a relationship with the pastor because I was called to the ministry and, you know, and asking him about the ministry and things like that. So he was nice to me, but what I learned is when they had meetings, they would have these business people that would use all this business jargon. And I'd learned some of that in the Army from total quality management and all this kind of stuff. And they used all these, you know, they would have all these schematics and all this stuff. And I was immediately, I was vexed in my spirit. Because I was like, hey, you know, you're turning the house of God into a house of, you know, merchandise. You're selling God. You're promoting, you know, and that's what they're doing. You know, not only about selling objects, but it's about, you know, presenting the services as a sales pitch to get people to join a church. I mean, that's what they do. All the sermons that they do in most churches that are successful in the world's eyes is by this sales pitch. You know, they can't do like the Catholics did in the Middle Ages. They just kill anybody that disagrees with, you know, impale people. You know, I lived in Germany for 7 years, and I went to, there's a medieval torture chambers there in one of the only cities not destroyed during World War II. I'm trying to think of the name of the place. It's on the Tauber River there. It's Rotenburg or Rotendorf on the Tauber, in English, on the Tauber River, Tauber River. And they have a, you know, a medieval dungeon there that's real, that was not destroyed during World War II. And, you know, and they have all those instruments and implements. Well, they put you inside the thing with the spikes in it, close it up on you, and then they impale you. In other words, they make you sit with your rear end on top of a spike, and then slowly you would go down on that thing, and it would skewer you and go up through your intestines and finally kill you. I mean, how sick and demonic is that? The things they would do, thumb screws and all kinds of demonic, satanic things. This was all done in the name of Christ by those demonic people, who did the Inquisitions and all that stuff. And then in the name of Christ, that unholy Roman Empire, that seat of Satan there in Rome, which anybody who would read history, that's why, you know, I get, you know, on a regular basis, and when I mention something about Roman Catholicism, there'll be someone who's a Catholic comment. And the bottom line is, because, and I don't know why I'm talking about this, but you'll hear Catholics say something like, well, you know, the Catholic Church has been around for 2,000 years. You know, it's an original church. Well, it's not. Catholic Church has really been around, you know, and it developed from the time of Constantine and developed more and more and more away from the gospel to what it is today. Anybody that would read the history of the Catholic Church and all the, there's no records in the early Inquisition. Millions and millions and millions of people have been killed in the name of religion, in the name of Christ, the Crusades, all those things. You know, nowhere in the Bible does it mandate for us to go to Jerusalem and start killing the Jews. And even though, you know, Muslims are doing a jihad or whatever now, it's because the Crusades. That's a big part of it. And, you know, they think Christian, they think Catholic. You know, for the Muslims, they're thinking the Vatican. You know, it's the seat of power of Christianity. Well, now, actually, it's not the seat of power of Christianity. The seat of power of Christianity is Christ in heaven. But the seat of power of earthly religious Babylon is in Rome. And why I talked about that, brothers and sisters, I couldn't tell you. But as the Lord would lead me. But what I wanted to talk to you guys about, and just mention it, like I said, there's lots of people that watch my videos for the teachings that I'm doing, and some, you know, a percent that watch for the things about the orphanages and the feedings, whole different groups of people. And anyway, as I told you guys, when I came here, I had the funds to buy the land, and for orphanage number 3, it's 4 hours from here. And then an opportunity came up to buy an already made house that's worth $120,000 and then get it for half price. The owner is he's a Chinese Filipino. There's lots of the wealthiest families in the Philippines, and the masters of business in the Philippines are of Chinese descent, almost completely all over the Philippines. And so this man is of Chinese descent, and his wife, and I had the privilege of, you know, praying for them before they knew me, before, because I prayed for them, because he had some demonization and they had some demon manifestations in their house. They're Catholics, but I've had a chance to pray for them several times, and then, you know, by the grace of God is using me to evangelize them. And in this process, they own a bunch of businesses, and they needed the liquidation now. And, you know, the Lord had lined it up. The Lord had it all lined up for me, for us to get it. And so, you know, I'm saying all this because I believe by faith God's going to make a way. And, you know, but I'm just asking for special prayer. I'm not really wavering in my faith. You know, I'm just asking because the Bible says one can put 1,000 to flight Two can put 10,000 to flight. And then as you would multiply that. So I need you guys' prayers, because I already made a down payment on the house of 10%. Okay. And the total cost of the house, actually with tax title and the whole nine yards, is pushing $70,000. Because all the expenses additional, you know, I was thinking it's supposed to be 60, but you have to do all of this title in the Philippines. You know, it's a huge expense, and it takes at least a year to transfer the land title from one person to the next. And you have all these taxes and fees. And, well, the Philippine government is the reason why the Philippines is not very prosperous. Besides the spiritual side, I mentioned a video the other day, lack of Christians here. But the second, you know, the fruit of the fact that there's no Christians here but 5 or 6% born-again Christians is a mega corrupt government. And I think most of your third world countries are like that. A lot of people in America are more familiar with Mexico, you know, and their corruption. Philippines is a lot like that, but probably not as violent as Mexico is. You know, they had the drug wars here and all that. Thank the Lord for that. But the same mentality of bribery and all this. So anyway, the cost is pushing $70,000. And so I already put down 10% on that. Praise the Lord, we had the funds for that. And, you know, I'm going to use my, I was going to use my personal savings, but I decided to get a loan after talking to, you know, the person that does my savings there and stuff in the States. And so I'm going to get a loan to buy the house. Because I have 30 days to pay the balance, because it's a cash price. I mean, you think you're buying a house, you know, that we could put 20 orphans in. Plus, it's got like five bedrooms. We have a bedroom for a mission room. Any of you guys visit, they can stay there. And then I have a room when I come, I can stay there too. So the expense of me having to rent a place and move my stuff and all that from orphanage number one, which is, you know, it costs me $300 or $400 to move my stuff and make. If, like this time when I rented a place, you had to put down a deposit, all those things, which you never get the deposit back. You know, so all those expenses would be gone for me and anyone that would visit here to have a place to stay. Plus, we got the orphans there. Plus, the place where our other orphanages are, there's really no high school. You know, in these remote areas, there's not a high school. You got to travel to somewhere to go to high school. So when our orphans would start high school, they would have to go to a city anyway, see, and then we'd have to rent a place or whatever. So this solves all that problem. When the orphans get old enough to go to high school, they can just move here to the house, the mission house, orphanage number three. I'm going to call this one orphanage number three. And the new land where we will build a building will be orphanage number four. So, because this one's ready to start immediately. It'll be able to move in 2 weeks. So we'll move some orphans in there. School gets out at the end of March. Can't really move anybody during the school year, generally speaking, unless they're not in school. Some of the orphans have never been to school. So we can get those guys. But what we'll do is the summertime here is April and May, and that's the time we'll move some orphans who are getting ready to go to high school up here, or just 1 or 2 years away here. And then we'll put new orphans in the old orphanage, you know, because I'm going to have a new house mom here. And I don't, you know, this to explain, just to discuss the strategy with those of you guys who care. I don't want to put new orphans with a new house mom here when I've already got these kids trained and evangelized and they can already know Bible verses and they're already Christians. Those children that are already at the orphanage number one and number two. So I can take the best of those kids here because I know they'll do the best and go to high school and everything. Some of these kids, they might not go to high school. I don't know. If their relatives try to pull them down and say, oh, you know, you're already 13, 14 years old. You don't need to be in an orphanage. Come on back here. And then next thing you know, they're on drugs or they're drinking or whatever with their bum relatives. I mean, this is the kind of things I've dealt with some orphans before. I've had orphans that aged out. Before I ever had any orphanages, I've had orphans living with pastors since I first came to the Philippines. When I came short term, 2005, 2006, I already got orphans. But I put them with local pastors, and then I gave money to that local pastor to take care of them before I started Joshua's ministry. And I've had some that went on. I had my first orphan just graduated nursing school last year, and then she just got her license. It's a big process. Another example of the corruption of the Philippines. It takes like a year or whatever to get your license. So she just got her license, and she's just starting to work like in the last month, since January, since Christmas, whatever. Her name is Diana. That's my first orphan. And now she's working as a nurse. The Philippines, they only have 10 years of school. Now they're going to 12 starting this year. But before last year and before, they only went to the 10th grade. So, you know, she went to college after the 10th grade. So really she's only, I guess she's like 20 years old, 21 maybe. She's 21 now. She's my first orphan, and she is a nurse. And then I had another orphan that ran off and got pregnant. I mean, you know, she left when she's like 15 or 16. She was only in the third grade. She could never pass the third grade, and so she ran off, and then, you know, she had a baby, and then she's living with some dude. And, you know, I've contacted her on Facebook, and she said hello, but, you know, I tried to get her to come here and talk to her and stuff, try to help her out. Again, they call her Mai Mai is her name, or May in English. Try to help her out. And her real name is Angelita, but they call her May May or Mai Mai in Filipino. And she's a good girl, but, you know, she couldn't get past the third grade. So, you know, she needed extra help. And, you know, the people that she was staying with were not able to give it to her. You know, and, who, you know, God would give somebody the grace to help these kind of kids. Then another girl that was a little bit, her father was insane. I don't know if it was demons or what. And then her mom was dead, so that's why we got her. And then when she was about 16, she started causing all kinds of trouble with the place she was staying at. And they had to kick her out because she was, like, committing crimes and stuff. It's a girl. And her name was Lynn. They called her Lynn. And they had to get rid of her because she was committing crimes, and the family couldn't handle it. You know, it was just too much. So these kind of things, you know, that I've dealt with in the past when the orphans become teenagers. So if they can be here, and then I'm going to be visiting here at least 3 months a year to the orphanage where the teenagers are, and then I can personally evaluate them. Can we help them or not? You know, you have to be, like I say, it always goes back to the old song, The Gambler, right? You got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, and know when to run. And so each person that I deal with as a preacher, as a pastor, you have to decide and discern whether you can help them or not. You can't always help everybody. There'll be one person that ties up all your time. You can't get nothing done. And it ends up it's from the enemy to stop you from doing what God called you to do. So you have to be wise. You have to be patient. But yet you have to be ready to cut ties if you have to. I mean, because there are people, and I'm telling you from 15 years as a pastor, and I heard this from pastors who've been pastors for 30, 40 years who told me this. There are people that will try to destroy you. They're signed from the enemy to destroy you, you know. And that's why I try, you know, in the past, by the grace of God, I haven't tried to get caught up in all this drama and stuff like that, because it's always the same. It's just, you know, it's just not going anywhere, you know. And so either you can help people or you can't. And if you can't help them, maybe somebody else can. Give it to the Lord and move on. And I've been making videos about that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm teaching in here with my prayer request. Anyway, I'm asking for special prayer because, I mean, God can do anything, but we're going to need $60,000 by, it's the date is April the 7th, but this man who I'm trying to evangelize, as I said, he and his wife, and I believe they will get saved. They're going to be in Manila because they have all these businesses where they do weddings and stuff, and weddings and they, you know, you can rent tuxedos and all this kind of stuff. And then they also design wedding dresses and all this. And then they rent for proms and all that kind of stuff. They've got offices in several places in the Philippines. And then also they go buy their materials and all this. So they're always traveling. And they're very well off people. Some of them may be some of the most wealthy people I've ever met in the Philippines. Nice people. And anyway, so he's going to be out of town actually until I think it's the 13th will be the day of April. So actually it's going to, you know, I'm having an extra week there because he's going to be in Manila to do the finalizing the payment and for the title and all that stuff. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm just putting this out there and I'm asking for your prayers. You know, brothers and sisters, as I said, there are people who their tithe for 1 month or maybe... I met people that fly around on a private jet. Maybe that's their tithe for a week. I don't know. But God, you know, can move some, you know, one person's heart to build both of these orphanages. And it's just like, you know, $5 to you and me. God can make a way, brothers and sisters. And I'm believing for that. You know, I've been walking by faith, and that's the name of my ministry. Until I changed it to Joshua's Ministry after the death of my stepson, that was in August 2012, The name of my ministry was Walking by Faith since I started, and that's the name the Lord gave me. And after I named it, then when I watched Christian television, I saw there was a ministry called Walking by Faith. But, of course, that's a national ministry. And, you know, I had several people because I had business cards made, you know, when I was new and I was on the radio. I was on a radio station every Sunday for 3 years. Every Sunday afternoon I preached at a radio station, and people would ask me, are you affiliated with this Walking by Faith National Ministry? No. This Lord gave me that name. So I've been, by the grace of God, I've been walking by faith, brothers and sisters. And so, as I say, I know all those things. I've been operating in those, and that's how, you know, all the things I've done, been able to accomplish for the Lord by His grace has been through faith. By grace, so you say, through faith. So all the things I've done for the Lord has been by His grace, but through faith. You know, and then this is a whole nother level. And a level, you know, that I haven't ever done before. And that's what God always wants to move you, like I mentioned in the video before. You go from the bear to the lion to the giant. You know, so we got to go from glory to glory. I know God will make a way, brothers and sisters. There's no doubt. I'm believing it because, you know, I've already committed myself and Joshua's ministry. And for myself, I'm not a reckless person, brothers and sisters. I've been, you know, saving my money. I've been a tight wad with my money. But when it comes to giving, I'm not a tightwad. But with my own self, you know, I don't, you know, live a lavish lifestyle, and I don't spend money on myself. I never have in my whole life. I've always been a tightwad. And, but you know, when it comes to giving and tithing myself and giving myself, of course, I've been doing that. You know, as I mentioned before, I'm just giving my testimony. Before I started Joshua's ministry, all the things I did was from my own savings. All the orphans I sponsored. And all the things I did from the Lord was from my own money. And I'm just saying that not as I'm telling you as an example. And it's part of my testimony. It doesn't mean anything to me. You can't outgive God. God always makes a way. And I'm believing, you know, that God will make a way. I stepped out big time. And I felt the Lord was leading me to do that. And I did that. And I'm trusting the Lord. And that's why I'm asking you guys to pray with me. Because, you know, walking on a tightrope, you know, if God doesn't make a way, there ain't going to be no way. I'll put it that way. If God don't make a way, there's not going to be a way. And I'm believing that He will. And I'm asking you guys to come in agreement with me. And we serve a big God. I know He can do all things. You know, and I know that there are ministries like on television. I mean, whoever you want to name. Billy Graham, you know, he does a crusade. I mean, you know, you can imagine. Maybe you've never thought about it to appreciate it. Or Perry Stone, or whoever you want to talk about. When Billy Graham and those guys do a crusade, who knows what it costs to set up a crusade? Like, you go to rent a baseball stadium, you know, anywhere like L.A. or even New York City. Billy Graham went to New York City, all kinds of places. You can imagine the cost of renting Yankee Stadium or whatever they did. Hundreds of thousands of dollars. I don't know the cost of something like that. Millions of dollars, maybe. I don't know. And you can imagine, you know, the faith for those things way more higher than what, you know, what we're trying to do here with orphanages. But, and God makes a way. So I know that this, you know, God owns it all. The cattle on 1,000 hills, as the Bible says. He owns the hills, all the hills and the gold thereof and all those things. And God will make a way. And I'm just asking. Because, you know, whenever you're in the, you know, in the season of looking for the manifestation, of course, that's where the rubber meets the road. That's where the axe meets the grindstone. That's where faith meets grace. You know, in that darkest hour when you're waiting and waiting for the response and anticipate. Part of faith is anticipating that God's going to do something. And brothers and sisters, and that's another reason why I'm making this video. I mean, I can't do it alone. You know, we got to come in agreement. And all of you guys who will come in agreement with me, for me, this to happen. And like one sister who messaged me because I'd said 120,000. That's for both orphanages. 60,000 that I really supposed to have before April the 13th. And like I said, I already got it lined up to get a loan through my savings institution in the U.S., to do that if I have to, because I've already, you know, I'll lose the 10%, let's put it that way. They can. I don't know that they will, but that's the agreement, the contract we made. But now these people are nice people, but I, you know, there's no need in doing them wrong. We've already made the deal, you know. And I don't want to, you know, mess up the deal because that's what I agreed to. But anyway, and then the other orphanage, it's like 60,000. That's what I think. This building is a whole lot nicer than the orphanages we already have. I could not build an orphanage for the price that he's selling to me for. He's selling to me for half price. This building is worth $120,000. That's the market value. So even on a bad day, you should be able to sell it for 100. And then by the grace of God, we're able to get it for 60, plus it's 10,000 for the tax title and all those fees and whatever. That's huge in the Philippines. So we can buy the land and build the other orphanage, and lock, stock, and barrel is, as they say, 60,000. That's why I said 120. But then a sister told me, you know, we should pray an agreement for 150 because you have more expenses. You never know. Let's make it 150 because, of course, if we have more money, we can do, you know, we can start looking at buying land for orphanage number 5. Hey, you know, we got to think big. And if the Lord willing, and the Lord, well, I know the Lord's willing. If the Lord would, if I would have the faith, then we would have the faith. God would let us build 100 orphanages all over the Philippines and other countries, wherever the Lord would make a way. Wherever an orphanage is needed, God will make a way and let us do it. You know, there's always things like that needed because the orphanage is also a church. We also do vacation Bible schools. You know, and so it's an outreach to the community. That's the purpose of the orphanages, is the future leaders of the church, long term, barring the return of the Lord, short term, you know, we have a church there. Every orphanage we have, we have church services and all that for the local people. And also vacation Bible school in the summer for kids, the local kids. So, you know, there's multi things we're doing. Plus, we're doing the feedings and all that through the churches that I work with in other areas and then through the orphanages. You know, so we're doing all things we can to evangelize and reach people. We have the boxes that people sent, brother and sister Opinga in California, and then sister Pearlie in Chicago. We've been sending boxes, great big boxes we can send cheap and bulk, the Filipino moving company here. And then we give away those clothes and evangelize the people, and it's spreading the love of Christ, and then we evangelize them and everything. We've been doing mighty things for God, and I'd like to do 100 times more as we feed 800 street kids a week, and I'd like to make it more. I'd like to feed 8,000 a week, you know, and God can make a way to multiply it, just like he multiplied the loaves and fish, you know, to 5,000 men. Go read the Bible. It says 5,000 men plus women and children. So that's a whole lot more. It's at least 15,000 or 20,000 that the Lord fed. People don't think about that. They don't pay attention to the text. Maybe. It says he fed 5,000 men plus women and children. So praise God, brothers and sisters. I'm tired out. Been trying to do some ministry with people through the internet, which is, you know, probably the bulk of my time. But, you know, that's what God called me to do. And I enjoy doing it. So don't hesitate. If you have a serious, you know, a legitimate situation, I'll be glad to help you. And I would thank the Lord that 90% of the people that contact me, you know, they have a great challenge for me, you know, their situation. Every once in a while, you know, you get somebody that I can't help. But 90% of the people that contact me, by the grace of God, I've been able to help them with a word of wisdom from the Lord, or you know, counseling in their personal situation, pastoral counseling, all those things. And it takes up a lot of my time. There's been people, rich business people, who have tried to discourage me on that. Oh, don't do that. No, that's what being a pastor is all about. The church is, as I said in the beginning of this video, church is not a business, even though it's good to use best business practices. But ultimately, it's how God wants it done. And so I don't do, these wealthy business people had advised me to do, you know, frequently asked questions. And when someone messaged me and asked me a question, just, you know, copy and paste and send them a standard answer and all that stuff. I ain't going to do it. And that's why, you know, I bumped head with these wealthy people, because I'm not going to do it business way. I'm not going to do it cardinal way. I'm going to do it the Lord's way. I'm going to do it by the Spirit of the living God. And, you know, and I don't care if the Lord wants orphanages built, which I believe he does, he will make a way. And I don't have to compromise or bow down to man or you know, move off of where the Lord, you know, wants me to preach and me to be as his servant to make it happen. And that's where, and maybe that's what I should have said. Maybe that's how these big ministries, most of them got their money, because they compromised. Not always true. Lots of times true. And I'm not going to do it. So, and the Lord has made a way so far, and if he wants, you know, he'll make a way, or it ain't going to happen. Except and the Bible verse, one of my favorite Bible verses for revivals, and it can be in this situation too. Psalm 127. Except the Lord build the house, those that labor in vain. And that's true. I'm not going to build any house or buy any house unless the Lord's going to be the one to do it. And I'm asking you, brothers and sisters, to come into agreement with me about this, that God will make a way. And then the amount, as the sister had suggested in the message to me, $150,000 to do both of these orphanages and get it done this year. And then I'm believing beyond that to do more orphanages and whole other islands of the Philippines, you know, one on every island, major island of the Philippines. There's thousands of islands in the Philippines. I think it's 7,000 islands, but there's only like, whatever, maybe 10 big ones with city on it or something. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I've been rambling on. I'm sure I probably said something in there that might have interested you here and there as I've been all over the map. But God bless you guys. I appreciate you guys. You know that I love you. And I appreciate all of you. And, you know, I thank the Lord that for his grace. And those of you, who I have bumped heads with, most of the time, the Lord's made a way that, you know, we've been reconciled because we, you know, begin to see things God's way, not our own way. And that's why it says in Amos 3:3, how can two walk together except there be an agreement? So if I'm following Christ and you're following Christ, well, surely we should be near each other. We should be walking together if we're both following Christ. So if we're not both following Christ, one of us or both of us, if we're not walking together, one of us or both of us is not following Christ. But we can. What we need to do is worry about ourselves and not what the other person is doing more. You know, I'm talking about the average Christian. We need to look at in the mirror first before we begin to, you know, cast stones. And that's just a sign of, you know, spiritual maturity, like I talked about in the video yesterday. And God bless you guys. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And I receive your prayers of agreement with me. And the Lord is outside space and time. And I appreciate it. And continue to solicit me for words of wisdom, words of knowledge. I was doing the public videos. If I have time, I'll go back and do more public videos. But I've been, you know, privately giving people words of wisdom and knowledge a lot. As you've seen. Some people, I made them public. That I gave them, it's up to them if they want to make it public or not. I don't care. That's their business. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I'll see you guys soon. Upstairs with the Lord, and then all of our labors of Joshua's ministry will be over with. We get to heaven, and I'm ready to go. God bless.